Hello, this book is titled Godlike Powers and Abilities, subtitled And How You Can Learn These Abilities for Yourself. Authored by Martin K. Ettington, narrated by Martin K. Ettington.
Hello, this is the introductory chapter. Hello, this is Marty Ettington. I'd like to welcome you to my book, Godlike Powers and Abilities, and How You Can Learn These Abilities for Yourself. I'll be doing the narration of this book, and I'll also mention a few extra things like what some of the pictures look like, etc., to give you a bigger, better flavor for what we'll be looking at. In this book, we will examine some of the most incredible stories and claims from history on powers and abilities, which, if true, would give us the potential to be as gods. In our modern civilization, we think we know it all and that science reigns supreme. Even though I'm an engineer and have worked in industry, computers, and software most of my life, I recognize the limited boundaries of science. Most of what we'll cover here is not currently measurable by science and is based purely on subjective experiences. I've decided to throw away all restraints on what is possible and forget trying to prove my case that these powers exist, as I've done in my earlier books. This book is written based on my faith and intuition, plus the case histories I've read, my experiences, and pure speculation. I will provide references and case histories where available. We are going to cross the bounds of what most people would say is possible and feasible into the never-never land of what would commonly be called impossible, and I'm looking forward to the trip. I must also say that I spend time mainly focused on my spiritual path, and I know that paranormal powers and abilities can be a great distraction from that path. Why in the world, then, would I write this book? Do I want to destroy the theme from my previous books that we should focus on and strive for spiritual development from learning inner peace? Not at all. I figure that most people who are interested in the spiritual development are also interested in these related subjects. They'll find the information somewhere at a certain point in their journey. These distracting subjects include all the paranormal and supernatural. At some point, most people are going to try to learn about other related subjects, so they might as well learn from somebody who has had their share of paranormal experiences and who has a spiritual focus. I consider myself someone who knows what to avoid and why, and am happy to share my advice and experiences with others. In addition, I just find all these things fascinating because they show what a malleable universe we live in, and that with a deep understanding of the spirit underlying reality, we can do many things considered impossible by Western civilization. I've found bits and pieces of what I want to cover here in many places, but I never found all of it together at a level where the writer really has a good understanding of what they were talking about. It should also be mentioned that all of the powers and abilities I refer to here were first written down in the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali over 2,000 years ago. These are not new ideas or ones that I've created. I hope you enjoy this journey. Marty Ettington, Fall 2009.
Chapter 1, The Scale of Believability. When I was in my second year as an undergraduate engineering student, I had an opportunity to run a psychic research course during the 1975 January term at RPI, or Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, under the auspices of the chairman of the physics department. The professor scheduled the course, and I worked with him to develop the material and taught a lot of it. At that point, I also read a lot of books on metaphysics and was a year into my own psychic development through meditation. I was the daily instructor to a class of about 25 other students where we did experiments on everything from pyramids to trying to hear messages from the dead on recording tapes. In looking for a way to explain psychic phenomena to the students, I came up with a scale of believability which I have become an ever stronger adherent to as I've gotten older. And here we see figure 1, a scale of believability on the left side, probably true, and an arrow, and then very likely, improbable, and a leap of faith going to the right, and then finally on the far right, impossible / ridiculous. The concept is simple. Imagine a scale with one end called probably true and the other end called impossible ridiculous. Then start listing unusual types of phenomena along the scale as to where they fall. An example scale might include the following key with these sample entries. Probably true, very likely, improbable, Leap of Faith, Impossible Ridiculous. Now, telepathy is probably true. Most people would agree with that. A very common occurrence is when you think of someone and they call you on the phone right away, or how many married couples think the same thoughts at the same time. Most people would agree, because of these events, telepathy probably exists as a natural human ability in some form, although it hasn't been validated by the accepted scientific standards yet. Now, psychic healing would be very likely. Many persons throughout history have reported natural healing from Christ to people in today's world. A lot of anecdotal evidence exists, and this is a common enough claim that most people would accept its existence. But they are still somewhat skeptical. Of course, the scientific community doesn't validate this either. Foretelling the future would be improbable. Again, something commonly claimed, the standard story being someone who dreamed that they saw a plane crash and then it happened. Now we're getting to something that is very subjective and can't be validated by today's scientific techniques. Out-of-the-body experience is a real leap of faith. Many books are written on this subject, and thousands of cases have been recorded, but it's a totally subjective experience and not measurable objectively today. Mental teleportation would be impossible ridiculous. I'm talking about Star Trek beaming capability without the machines. This is really getting to the edge. But again, if you search the literature, there are cases of this event reported throughout history, although it is extremely rare. The reason that I'm introducing you, the reader, to this scale is how I'm organizing the power and abilities to be discussed in this book. In this book, we will proceed from an examination of phenomena which are mostly accepted to ones which most people consider impossible and ridiculous. It's hard to tell if I have the sequence correct, because ultimately these phenomena are all related to the underlying spirit which created the universe, and therefore there is no one correct order. In the next chapter, we review the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, which are an analytical exposition of the science of yoga and a compilation of abilities to be achieved from that path. Chapter 2, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. And below this we see an image of Patanjali in a statue. I first learned about reading the Yoga Sutras when I was about 19, and it has impressed me to this day as a well-written exposition for enlightenment and an analytical view of yoga. I believe the sutras also describe the underlying reality behind all religions and mystical philosophies. The Yoga Sutras of Patanjali was written in four books in the Sanskrit language and one of the greatest spiritual works of India. It is available in print and many versions on the internet and describes the path to enlightenment and attainment of spiritual powers. The sutras were written over 2,000 years ago by some estimates. The sutras are often described as a scientific exposition in the science of yoga and consists of four books of sutras in Sanskrit, which has numerous translations in English. Each book was written in short sentences of Sanskrit, so many publications of the Yoga Sutras today include the following. The original Sanskrit text, the phonetic and exact word translation, turning the previous into an English sentence, and a written exposition on the meaning and details of each sutra. Next diagram shows some sutras in Sanskrit on wooden strips. All of the human abilities and powers and more referred to in the sutras are found in Book 3. The goal of the yogic path and the sutras is enlightenment. However, many spiritual powers become side effects of the spiritual process. Many sutras describe different abilities and how those abilities can be derived. As an example, although the sutras don't talk specifically of physical immortality, the powers available as a result of the spiritual development process would also affect the body in a very positive manner. In Book 3, Sutra 45, we have an example of what I'm referring to as regarding spiritual powers from the process of enlightenment, which would probably cause a lot of longevity in the physical body if exercised properly. Book 3, Sutra 45. Thereupon will come the manifestation of the atomic and other powers, which are the endowment of the body together with its unassailable force. The body in question is, of course, the etheric body of spiritual.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.